for all verified facts. Subscribe to our YouTube channel and click the bell icon to get the latest updates.
Hello and welcome. Several drug makers are now announcing that they're moving on to expanded phase two of clinical trials for a vaccine for COVID-19. As a background, some 165 vaccines are now being developed. Phase two of testing usually involves a larger pool of candidates and focus groups of children enrolled, and it's considered an important phase. Some 12 candidates are believed to be at this stage globally, and there are a few others which have started phase three as well, like the vaccines from Oxford University. So the question is really, what does this mean when we go into such trials? Does this mean that a vaccine can or is really around the corner? What should people who are likely or wanting to take them expect, or what should they be careful of? Particularly that we are at an early stage of research. To discuss this, I'm joined by two experts, Dr. S.P. Kalantri, Director, Professor of Medicine at the Mahatma Gandhi Institute of Medical Sciences and Medical Superintendent of Kasturba College in Sevagram. Dr. Kalantri has a Master's in Public Health in Epidemiology from the School of Public Health, University of California, Berkeley. And I'm also joined by Dr. N. Kumaraswamy, Chief and Director of Infectious Diseases Medical Center at the VHS Hospital in Chennai. He's also a Director and Site Leader for the Chennai Antiviral Research and Treatment Clinical Research Site of the U.S. National Institutes of Health. He's also a Clinical Investigator for ongoing clinical research trials of University of California, San Diego, and Harvard University in Boston. Thank you both for joining me. Dr. Kalantri, let me ask you first, what's your reading on where we stand in these clinical trials, and more as lay consumers or audiences, what should we be reading into them?
Well, I'm reminded of a famous quote about British weather that says that the only certainty in British weather is glorious uncertainty. And I guess the same holds true for this virus also. Nobody knows how it's going to behave. Nobody can predict its future. And I must say that even the virus doesn't know that how it's going to behave. So all our predictions, all our future projections, I think they are very uncertain. The virus is very unpredictable. And we don't, honestly speaking, I don't know what the future holds for us.
Right. Okay. So that's a broad take. So let me get Dr. Kumaraswamy here. What's your reading, Dr. Kumaraswamy, of where we are in clinical trials? Are you or your organizations involved in any?
Of course. You know, I'm from both a clinical unit. I take care of COVID patients. Also, we do a lot of clinical trials, both on COVID patients as well as on negative people to prevent various diseases. Now, coming to your question on vaccines, you know, for any vaccine, for a target discovery or a validation from preclinical stage to manufacturing development and clinical assay optimization, it takes anything from 3 to 8 years in a normal scenario, you know, right? But on the other hand, we are in, you know, a huge pandemic. Things are very accelerated, you know, and some of them are, the processes are very truncated. They may be good and bad. Good is you'll get some product soon. Or on the hand, bad, you might even bypass some stages, which may, you know, hurt some individuals if not properly being, you know, carried out. So the normal scenario is 3 to 8 years, but now everyone on the race. As you rightly said, there are several candidates on that. Usually, you know, we do phase one safety study in a very small group of people. And, you know, the next phase, we go into phase two, where we do both for the safety and as well as for the immunogenicity. That is something. What is whether vaccine will protect you against a particular organisms. And only in the phase three, we'll test it about the efficacy and also on a safety on a large number of people against a comparator arm, which is usually a, you know, placebo. So all these, you know, usually takes anything from 2 to 10 years. You know, I was involved in, you know, several other vaccine development clinical trials in the past, starting from HPV and some of those TB vaccine, you know, candidates, and now maybe I'm getting involved in, you know, this COVID vaccine development. This is a usual process, but on the other hand, some other processes can be fast forward and truncated, but not always in an ideal scenario. And again, as you rightly said, there are several candidates now, you know, people are on the race. There are, till now, I just got some updates from, you know, vaccine sites, almost around 440 plus COVID vaccines are already on preclinical stage. You know, they have been testing preclinically before going to the phase one. You know, what about, you know, whether it can be used. And among them, almost 19 now in phase one trials. It's a huge, in such a 6 months of time, I've never seen in, you know, any other infectious disease that so many candidates are come so quickly into that phase one. And also 12 are already in phase two. You know, that's remarkable, you know, in this pandemic, which is really needed. And almost on five, you know, they are all into the, you know, phase three. Now, right. This is something what's been currently been, you know, going on. But on the other hand, we need to do this in a very systematic, ethical way so that it can be applied in a very large masses without causing major issues to those right. negative people, you know, for the, you know, process of preventing this COVID disease.
Right. And I'm going to come back to what the trials are showing or likely to show. Dr. Kalantri, what's your sense? I mean, at this point, if you were to, I mean, as a practitioner, someone who is in the front lines of medicine, do you get a sense that the effort that we're putting in should be will be more rewarded in the form of a cure or in the form of a vaccine, while all efforts will be ongoing at any point?
I guess both things are important, prevention as well as cure. So primary prevention is important. We need to have a vaccine to make sure that the healthy individuals do not fall sick. And when these individuals fall sick and get admitted to the hospital, we also need novel drugs to make sure that when we don't use them or we keep them off our hospitals as well. But as has repeatedly been told, and one of the editorials in the New England Journal of Medicine very beautifully said that normally a vaccine takes about 6 to 10 years. But thanks to the tremendous efforts by the scientific community, by researchers, by virologists, by public health people, by World Health Organization and the United Nations, we've been able to collapse the 6 years into 6 months, which is a remarkable achievement. But I must say that I would urge a note of caution that, well, we are past phase one and phase two. The initial results look quite promising, that probably the vaccines are safe, probably they are able to mount immunogenic effect there, but the real test of the vaccine would lie in phase three trial, where hundreds and thousands of individuals and healthy volunteers would participate in the study, and then we try to find out, well, whether the vaccine is really safe, whether the vaccine is really beneficial, what is its protective effect. So probably it might take about 6 months, 9 months, or a year before the phase three studies are completed, and we start getting some clearer picture as to where we are. But right now, I would again urge a note of caution that, well, it's time that the speed is of essence, but while we are speeding, but we should not lose sight of science and ethics as well.
Right. Dr. Kumaraswamy, so, you know, as again, if I was asking this question as a layperson, how do I feel confident that the effort that's being put in and the standards that are being used to test in the case of clinical trials are consistent across the world? And including in our own country, where, let's say, many drug makers are saying that they've gone into phase two.
Right. I know it's a very challenging question. Now, usually these vaccine developments, the phase one and, you know, the preclinical and phase ones are usually done by the industry, you know, because they are the one who are involved in vaccine discovery. And they do these in a small group of people to understand the safety in the healthy volunteers. And once that is done, in a common scenario, phase two and phase three are usually done by academic bodies. You know, that is because so that there won't be any confounders where you're not biased towards your own product which you have been developed in your own company. So in academic bodies like National Institute of Health, which is in the United States, that we call NIH, or these French agencies like ANRS, or UK's Medical Research Council, or in India, we have an academic body called ICMR, Indian Council of Medical Research. You know, this type of bodies usually does in a multi-site way so that to avoid biases, but using the industry developed products. So again, having said this, to your question, how one can really be reassured they do this very well. So I think these academic bodies, you know, they select investigators and who are capable of leading this clinical trial, make sure that all those various processes in clinical trials stages, starting from, you know, appropriate reviews by the ethics committees are being obtained, and the needy population is being approached and being recruited with a proper informed consent after explaining everything about the clinical trial, about the risk, harm, benefits and everything, and also about the need for follow-up, and also doing all those blood tests and everything, you know, which needs a lot of time-consuming procedures, particularly in negative people coming to enter into these clinical trials. And also conduct these clinical trial in a very highly ethical manner with a team of staff, not just one individual alone, and also collect the data in a very professional way, and also without any bias and without any tampering, without any malpractice, and also reporting all the appropriate adverse events and serious adverse events. There is a side effects following these products like vaccines, even starting from small things like when a vaccine is being given as an injection, when it's a pain, itching, you know, swelling, or even the serious things like certain anaphylaxis-like reaction, that is, you know, someone can get faint down while you're giving vaccine, you know, administration.
Right. And also, you know, if I can interject there, I mean, would we be right in assuming that at this point there is no reaction at all because we're not hearing anything, or is it that we are not told this at this point?
I think, you know, I've been done so many clinical trials, you know, developed so many HIV antiretroviral medications, hepatitis B, C, TB, and so many things, and even vaccines. Everything will have some type of an adverse event. You know, there are two types of things. One is called adverse event, another is serious adverse event. The adverse event is, there is a classification. You know, we have got a different grades, like grade 1, 2, 3, and 4. Usually anything more than grade 2, that is very severe, 3 and 4, where you may have to stop the product and you have to enter them into the standard of care.
Right.
Grade 1 and 2, sometimes we allow them, you know, if it is not serious, not going to be progressive to grade 3. So to your question, I think everything will have some type of an adverse event, starting from if you are a oral tablet, something nausea, vomiting, or stomach pain, or itching. And if it's an injection in the form of a vaccine, everybody will complain of pain, you know, because there will be a questionnaire, you know, after giving a vaccine, is it painful? People will say yes. If they're not saying, yeah, yes, they're saying no, that means they have not given, you know, any small needle, if you touch, it will have a pain. And some of them, you can have a little swelling there. And some of those vaccines, which you all know that, can produce a fever after 2 or 3 days. So that means your body...
Right, but those are things that we're familiar with. I mean, as children who've been vaccinated and so on.
Yes, that's right. So I think in a vaccine trial, we report all those. We'll never say that, you know, there is no adverse event at all. But on the other hand, the regulators look into these adverse events, whether it is related to vaccine or is a general process or it is not at all life-threatening. But on the other hand, benefit following this vaccine has been great as compared to this minor pain and whatever itching, you know, you get. So I think that is up to the regulators. They have a group of body, they look into that. But on the other hand, to your question, every trial will have some adverse events in that.
Fair enough. Yeah, Dr. Kalathri, so, I mean, going by the information we have so far on the clinical trials being conducted, and as we've all seen now that we seem to be galloping ahead at very high rates, what's your sense now? I mean, how are you looking at this? I know you said that this takes time. This has to be viewed with a certain degree of ethics, but it is moving fast and it is going to hit the market, and there is going to be a lot of publicity as these things start coming in. So what do we do?
I think it's extremely important for the scientific community to adhere to the highest principles of both science as well as ethics, and not those political forces and cheap popularity and the pressures from media, etc., be the driving force for the development of vaccine. The phase 3 is going to be extremely crucial, because this is a phase when you are going to enroll about hundreds and thousands of participants. You are going to test them. They have volunteered themselves. They don't know right now whether they would really be benefited from this vaccine, but probably they think when they are signing on the informed consent forms that, well, they are volunteered, because they feel that if this vaccine turns out to be a successful vaccine, probably the future generation might help. So they have probably volunteered themselves into these clinical trials with a very altruistic mechanism, and we need to acknowledge that. But what would be extremely crucial would be to capture and record almost every adverse event. This could be a small fever or pain or swelling or giddiness or skin rashes, or some even the serious complications as well. Because right now we don't know about whether this vaccine is really safe, whether this vaccine is really effective, how much it has its protective effect is. And if the past experience with the vaccines is anything to go by, we do know that certain vaccines were found to have very delayed but very serious toxicity. There were a few controversies as well. For example, certain vaccines were associated with autism. The rotavirus vaccine in India was associated with a peculiar intestinal obstruction in some kids. And therefore, unless we capture these events and we establish a cause and effect relationship between the vaccine and these adverse events, it will be very premature to celebrate the victory and break into a victory dance. So I would always say that while it's important that speed is of essence, but please do ensure that you make haste slowly.
Right. And let me ask you the question a little more medically. So going by what you've seen of this disease so far, and it's been more than 4 months now that you've been actively working with it and around it, what's your sense? I mean, are the whatever the literature that you've seen on vaccines, do they look like they could potentially fight this?
It's quite possible, but my honest answer is that I don't know, because the virus is unknown. We don't know whether the virus would mutate. We don't know whether there would be a cross-reactivity. We don't know how our own immune system now responds to these vaccines. So right now, these are all conjectures right now. And probably as the time unfolds, probably over the next few months or so, or probably by the early 2021, we should be able to figure out exactly where we stand. So right now, the situation is very fluid.
Right. And last question to you, Dr. Kumaraswamy. So you've worked on infectious diseases for a while. And as you said, you've also looked at vaccines or worked with clinical trials for vaccines elsewhere. So what's your sense on, what the likelihood of its efficacy is, if you were to look at it somewhat dispassionately?
I think if you look into those available data, because COVID science is a very robust science, every day there's something new going on. Now, we have different types of vaccine. One is, do you have some time, 1 minute or 2 minutes, I can explain about
Please.
All those, or are you running short of time? Okay. So yeah. We have different types of vaccine. We have a DNA-driven vaccine, RNA vaccine, and also we use certain protein-based, vaccines. Now, everything does different things. And also among them, there are different types of things. We use certain what is called vector to give to those individuals to stimulate the response. Now, it can be a viral vector, or which can be a non-replicating. It won't replicate, so it can be given as a viral vector, or one of those viral vector which can be replicating, which sometimes you have to be very careful, which can also cause a disease. Another one is really we'll use a virus, but inactivate the virus and give. So there are various ways we give that. Each one will have a different efficacy, but all will finally does the same thing. You stimulate the immune response to protect against the diseases. So if you put all those these background thing into that, I think among all those data currently available scientifically, not through the media, which somebody has released anything in efficacy. So scientifically, which is documented, which is peer reviewed by researchers and been accepted, I think there are two vaccines which are really in a very advanced phase. One is mRNA vaccine, which I am sure you are very much aware of. That's developed by Moderna in collaboration US National Institute of Health, which is an advanced clinical trial. Now they have already started the phase 3, which has shown really good response. We need to wait for it. But again, Anthony Fauci, who leads the NIH efforts, very clearly says that wait up to early 2021. It's too early to speculate, but that's really gone into the very advanced phase of the study.
Right.
And another vaccine, which is really, to me, after reviewing all those literature and all those, is the one by the Oxford Group's vaccine, which again, you are aware of that, which again, been well focused in the media multiple times, which is again, adenovirus. We call it Chim Adeno Oxford 1 virus. It's a chimeric adenovirus vector, which was developed by the Oxford Group, which has really, gone into good clinical trials. And they have also shown about the adverse events and all those, not very significant to disrupt all, mild to moderate, and which people can adjust to that. It has shown a lot of immunogenicity, which is now in the advanced phase 3, which an Indian company is also been partnering with them, Serum Institute, and now Drug Control of India 48 hours back have approved this to conduct this clinical trial. It's what is called phase 2b to 3. So that means they completed phase 1, safety is gone. Phase 2 showed phase safety and immunogenicity. That means it stimulates some protection effect in the healthy volunteers. Now it has to be studied in phase 2B to 3, whether it has been really efficacious. So I think to me, these two vaccines are really in the advanced state. That is one by the Moderna in collaboration with US NIH, and this is one by Oxford group, Chimeric adenovirus, OX1 in COVID. So this is something what we need to wait for these results. And again, these are all very robust groups like NIH and Oxford. And they do studies in a very ethical way, in a very systematic way, involving the proper design. I think we need to wait for these results in a very optimistic way.
Right. Dr. Kalantri, last word from you. Two things. One is, how do you read what Dr. Kumaraswamy is saying? And secondly, you know, we were supposed to be launching or targeting a launch for a vaccine on August 15th, which may not happen, but that is how we were approaching the issue. So what's your advice to those who will be watching this or reading this later?
I guess it's extremely important to go by real researchers say, and I'm reminded of some of the statements by Dr. Soumya Swaminathan, as well as Dr. Fauci, Anthony Fauci, who said that we might see the birth of this vaccine by the winter of 2020 or probably the summer of 2021, comma, provided we are extremely lucky. And I think that is very important for us to understand that the virus development is going on, the vaccine development is going by leaps and bounds, but then it would be very premature to find out whether the vaccine would really be available in the next couple of months or not. So probably we need to wait. We need to have a lot of patience there. And maybe that, God willing, well, probably the early 2021 might see this vaccine.
Right. Dr. Kalantri and Dr. Kumaraswamy, thank you very much for joining me. And I do wish, as always, you and your teams all the very best in this fight against this dreaded disease. Thank you very much.
Sure. Stay safe and let us be optimistic. We'll have a vaccine by early next year.
Thank you so much. Thank you.